standing at the moment of silence, followed by the pledge of allegiance.
I pledge.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Item one is to review of the agenda. Any questions, comments, additions? If not, do we have a motion? Motion by Ms. Hall, we have a second. Second by Mr. Dennett, all in favor? Aye, passes four zero. Next is the consider approval of the minutes for March 28, 23 regular meeting. Any questions, comments? We have a motion. Motion by Mr. Dorsey. Have a second. Second by Ms. Hall, all in favor?
Aye.
Passes four zero. Consider approval of minutes for April 11, 23 special meeting. Any comments, questions? Motion. Motion by Mr. Dennett.
Yes, I'll second that.
Second by Mr. Dorsey. All in favor?
Aye.
Passes four zero. Next item is student recognition. Ms. Christie Bush.
First, we'd like to start with something new. Mr. Howard had charged our team, along with Mr. Watkins, to come up with the answer to this question for counties around us, for students in his county that don't go to public school. Why choose Watkins? So Mr. Watkins and our team started brainstorming, where do we need to start? So we had two amazing young ladies, Ms. Ava Willem and Ms. Emma Rose. I'm sure you've seen them. They're students that are juniors at George Rogers Clark, and they love videoing, and they are very talented with that. So we asked them, along with Mrs. Crosby, their instructor, to help us construct something that would be professional and worthy of the stage. And as in stage, if you'll close your eyes for a moment, pretend you're getting ready at the movie theater, whether it's Lexington or here or in Mount Sterling, you're getting ready for the previews and your movie, and then all of a sudden you see this. Evening, we are going to recognize side of the stage, and then you'll exit on the left side. All right, we will start with our mass team going to nationals. If you will please find your way to the stage. We have Clay Goff, Hudson Montgomery, Gunnar Willoughby, and Bryce Alfrey, and they are coached by Mr. Billy. Each team will wait for just one moment for a picture. The basketball team, Willard R. Clark, KHSAA, state runner-up. Jayla Mary, Maddox Campbell, Eli Craig, Trent Edwards, J.P. Gaines, Montel Gay, Kareem Durant, Rashawn Hampton, Braxton Martin, Tyler Maxwell, Camden McLaughlin, Jerome Morton, Chase Price, Sam Parrish, Hampton Taylor, Gunnar Woods, Brady Neely, and coaching staff. Girls basketball team, George Rogers Clark, KASAA, state final four. Brianna Myers, Sierra Myers, Riley Chestnut, Kylie Chestnut, Isabel, Trinity Gay, Jaylen Goodman, Aaliyah Graham, Anita Miller, Keisha Parker, Madeline Settles, Kylie, Kendall Stamper, Ms. Tabor, Brooke Taylor, Ms. Horton, Michaela Fountain, and Kaylin McKenzie. Cheerleaders placed fifth in the KHSAA state competition made it today to the USA Nationals at World Disney. KHSAA Sweet 16, 16 in-game runners up. That's a mouthful. Jamie Atkins, Brooklyn Atkins, Carly Aldridge, Sophie Blair, Macy Daniel, Tyra Duncan, Tatum Durham, Claire Ginter, Madeline Going, Maddie Huff, Amelia Jones, Megan Lawson, Annabelle Lucas, Brianna Richardson, Jalen Risen, Sydney Wilkins, Mallory Willoughby, and Ava Woolham. Joseph Booth, Portland Crabtree, Christopher Neverett, Hannah Platt, Kenan Robinson, and Charlie Wesley. We also have our junior high All-State Choir, Phoenix Behrman. Skills USA. Brandon Lewis placed third. Blake Hall placed third. Lyndon Chenault placed first. Nationals in Atlanta, Georgia to represent Kentucky in these events. This is a 100% nursing aid, if we may have all these members and our teachers. Sienna Arai, Caitlin Banks, Sophie Blair, Kaylee Brady, Madison Branham, Cameron Bryant, Brianna Byers, Ella Craven, Jaden Lawson, Julia Martinez, Ellie McCord, Connor McGrath, Brianna Richardson, Maddox Sherman, Emma Taylor, Alex Toller, Riley Van Hoos, Aaliyah Parker, Blair Rainey, Alexis Ritchie, Anna Rogers, Drake Fillette, DeShayla Baker, Cindy Miller, Shandalyn Nichols, and Andrea Clark. This is a lot of 100s. Brianna Richardson, this is for phlebotomy. Brianna Richardson, Alexa Toller, Brianna Byers, Shandalyn Nichols, Jaden Lawson, Riley Van Hoos, Megan Burton, Ella Cravens, Emma Taylor, Alexis Ritchie, Rashawn Hampton, Sienna Array, so sorry. DeShayla Baker, Sophie Blair, Ella McCord, Blair Rainey, Anna Rogers, Cindy Miller, Kylie Brady, Maddox Sherman, Connor McGrath, and Drake Tillett. Physical therapy assistant, Tennyson Prater, Ella McCord, Alexa Toller, Connor McGrath, and Allie Mullins. Automotive service excellence. Grant McCoy, Nick Warren, Aaron May, Christian Taylor, Jackson Woods, Logan Hollifield, James Bowman, Hayden Jackson, Carly Stewart, Aiden Larkin, Cameron Richardson, Alex Smith, and Winston Jones. Aiden Winston, and William Hummel.
Mr. Willoughby, great welding teacher.
Fischel, Nathan Muse, Devlin Gray, Austin Martin, Zachary Lamb, Joshua Hall, Caden Spicer, Hudson Bishop, Jason Crickraft, and Jacob Settles. Computer Science, Aiden Boggs, Jason Arwin, Jesse Baker, Joseph Booth, Charles Castle, Tobias Quattle, Jacob Davison, Aiden Forge, Daniel Graves, Ethan Green, Christian Eisen, Connor Lorette, Ian Markham, Nicholas Rice, Michael Shaman, William Tipton, and Andrew Sobolski. I hope that's right. Congratulations to each and all.
Good evening. Thank you for being here this evening, hosting us here, and also the opportunity to provide a little update. You'll see when we go through this a lot, one of the things we really tried to do beginning last year was get the community more involved on our campus and in our building. So we really enjoy this, and we'll host meetings anytime that you would like. I did get the going to be a quick snapshot of some of the high points that I know. We're going to forget some things, but at least get you an idea. We try to revolve most things around GRC, growth, respect, and community. And I don't annoy the students every day with announcements, but what I do, we try to build that into the announcements and have those three staples. And with the growth piece, we just talk about being a better version of yourself today than you were yesterday. Respect. Make good decisions. Be where you're supposed to be, do what you're supposed to do. Respect your staff, your peers, and just as importantly, respect yourself. And then the community piece, just we strive every day and make an effort to make somebody else's day better. And we just keep mentioning that, and we do those three things. We're going to change the culture inside our halls, and we also touch our community. So making those good decisions. So we grouped a few things into growth, respect, and community. And I'll have to take a look at this from time to time. I think the very first one is Academic Showcase. Again, working on getting community in our building. We had our very first Academic Showcase this year, and it was a huge success. Had a lot of community members come in our building. Gave them some feedback forms. They were able to go into different classrooms, take a look, some of the great things we had going on. Left us some really good feedback to make this even better next year. So we hope that that's something we'll continue to do. One goal, it's our first year participating in this. I think this was a grant that Mr. Howard has been applied for. But it is a partnership with the Kentucky Department of Education and Council on Post-Secondary Education. And it focuses in on ensuring the structures in place, ensuring post-secondary success for our students, whether that's college or career. One of the best things that I think is going to be coming out of this is a monitoring piece for our students once they do graduate. And getting that feedback and see if they're successful or not. Having that data can tell us if we're not being as successful as we think, then we can make the changes on our end that we do increase that success rate. And that's what we're excited about that. I already test our students three times a year, and it worked like it should. We showed growth, so our students improved, from the first test to the last test. What's really good about this is IREDY is district-wide, so we stick with this for several years. We're going to get some valuable data. Students come in as freshmen, we could have 7-8 years worth of IREDY data that, again, talks really well from school to school, that enables us to make sure that we are putting students where they need to be and meeting their needs. Co-teaching, really excited about some changes we're making to our co-teaching program next year. We visited Boyle County High School to see some of the great things that they have going on. So we are able to have the co-teaching program, intentional pairing of teachers, and also intentional making sure that we've got teachers and those co-teachers in the right subjects too. I think we've got some training this summer that is just going to really change the dynamics of everything with our station teaching and that. So I think that we're going to see a lot more hands-on engagement in our classrooms because of this. Pathways, dual credit, AP enrollments. We like to think that we have something that we can offer every student that walks in our building. What we have to make sure that we are really mindful of is making sure we reach every student to make sure that they have a place that they're doing something that interests them. But we have those things. We have, I guess, overall, closely probably 20 pathways. Work closely with the ATC. And then we also have some other pathways on the GRC side. Dual credit, AP enrollments. They keep increasing, but sometimes we'll get an influx in dual credit. AP might slide a little bit and vice versa. We started the first time this year a partnership with BCTC where we have about 15 students who never really come on our campus. They go to BCTC, get their high school graduation and high school credits along with dual credits and will graduate with an associate's degree before they graduate high school. Hopefully that's going to continue to climb. And we also, even this year, she did it on her own, we can't take a whole lot of credit for it. We have a student that will be our first student that will have an associate's degree before she graduates high school. So we're really proud of that. MTSS, our multi-tiered systems of support. Not a whole lot that you find on the internet about high school and MTSS. There's some, but so working with our admin team, central office, putting some nice things together about that. It ties in nicely with IREDY when we start looking at tiered instruction, interventions, and also the tiered behavior model. And then we just, again, another set of eyes, checking for patterns of behavior and academics so that we can intervene with them. This time it's not on me when they slow it down. We'll start talking about respect a little bit with BAR. You'll probably hear more about BAR at the next board meeting, but we visited Johnson Central three times with a core group of teachers and admin to see what they're doing with this program, building assets, reducing risk. The freshman year is such a predictor of what the future looks like. So this is a structured program, embedded lessons, that does. When we start talking about meeting the needs of every student, building those positive relationships, this is a great program. It's not an academic program. The schools that implement this, academics also improves. We also had a call, they've been doing it 8 years, it runs smooth. We had a call the other day with Woodford County in their first year doing it. And just the strides that they've made. So we're real excited about that, and you'll hear more about that next month. It might not seem like much, but we've never had a student of the month. And it is a big deal. So we set some criteria, our students nominate. We have a grade level student of the month. We have some nice wings up in our hall. We take pictures, certificates. So really nice recognition for our students. First time doing that. Kagan, we have a team of our admin and some teacher leaders that are going through the coaching training for this right now. And then this summer, every teacher in the district will be trained on Kagan. So just real excited about that. We had some walkthroughs today, saw some really good things going on in our classroom, but again, it's engagement and a different way of doing things, and it gets students and teachers excited. I was really excited about Kagan. We have a really strong and active student council. They come to us with a lot of ideas, and what's really good about them too is they might come to us with a concern, but then they also come with some solutions on some of the things that they think would help our school. So they are active, and very proud of them. council committees. We've not always had committees, worked closely with Mr. Howard and helping with that. We had some bylaws and now we're following. And we should have always been, but just again, those committees meeting, having leaders, and then presenting to our council, just helping advise our council on making decisions. Superintendent Advisory Council, our students love that. Mr. Howard's been a great job with that. They also took a nice trip today in the community. So a lot of good things going. And then we had also started a student equity council this year. It's just started. They made some school visits, but again, just having them at the table and talking about opportunities as much as we can provide all our students. And then with community, again, trying to get some folks in our building again, just to see, we've got great things going on. So then we've got the college fair, a lot of colleges coming in, and our students able to talk to them. Title One nights, our attendance has grown throughout the years on that, and I think it was really, really good coming out of COVID, and it's maintained. But it's an opportunity to have people in our building and then having conversations with our staff. FAFSA night went over really well. I don't know if any of y'all have had to fill out FAFSA. 16 times with $2 I've had to fill that out, and it's not pleasant. So we had a night to where parents could come in, and our counseling staff helped them fill out FAFSA. And the feedback on that was really good. So just, again, opportunities providing, helping, getting people in our building. Veterans Day, I put our Veterans Day symbol up against, you know, anybody. And I'm emotional when it comes to that, but it happens. Well deserved. Our ROTC does a great job of that, and really proud of, and again, community coming into our building. Leadership Winchester, several students that are in there, they have their meetings in our building, take them for tours, let them see the great things going on in our classroom. For the first time, our high school is also a member of Chamber of Commerce, working really close with Ms. Banks. They have Chamber of Commerce meetings in our building. So we open this bad boy up and show it off every chance we get. Candidate forum that's down at the bottom. You know, leading into a candidate forum before the elections, we also had a registration process for our students who were able to register and haven't yet. So got them signed up to register to vote, and then we had a candidate forum to come in and around the arena, and our students were able to come in and visit and talk with candidates. And just a big part of that is realize the importance of the civic duty to vote and have that voice. That was what we see. And two of the things that we started last year that I think is really good. The first one is a difference maker. Any senior who wants to can nominate anyone in their educational career that has made a positive impact on them educationally. And we invite, they know they're coming for a reason, they just don't know who it is that nominated them. So we set them at a table, have a nice dinner. They write their difference maker a letter as to why they were chosen, and well, emotional, I cry. Just it's touching, and our staff needs to hear that you know, you heard something, I didn't even know that I made that much of an impact, but that's the impact that we had on our kids' lives. So do that and have a nice little, I call it crystal, I think it's glass, difference maker. And then the Cardinal Gala, I'll be sending out some invitations on that. Again, just showcasing our students. Our culinary department makes the food with ag. Then we showcase our fine arts with jazz band, orchestra, Cardinal singers, ATC, well, other in our art departments put together silent auction materials. So we're just showcasing some of the great things that our students do. It's a dinner to show. There's a little bit of a cost with it too, but people pay it, and I hope that attendance increases and that all the proceeds from that goes to help fund what we do for our holiday shopping for some of our most needy students who may not. So just again, giving back, and one of the teachers put at the bottom of it, it's give, receive, cherish, and I thought that was very touching for that. And then all in, we just talk about being all in on whatever we do, let's try our best, all in on our effort, dedication, relationships, just all in, anything worth doing right, and putting our all in it. And that's it. Yeah, in a nutshell.
Any questions for Mr. Gee? Comment?
Anybody have the official time? thank you. And we appreciate it. We talk often about, you know, there's a lot of great things. You see all the recognitions tonight. Great things going on in our district. And again, it starts with our board and our central office. We've got a great admin team, certified classified staff, but really, we have the best students. I mean, they're worth a lot of the time that we put into them.
Thank you.
Next item is Area Technology Center update. So we're connected to GRC. As many of you all know, we're at the back end of it, and so GRC students just walk on into our hallways, and so we all share the same students. So I mean, we have a very interesting dynamic because there's not many ATCs that only serve one few schools. So a lot of ATCs serve multiple schools. You know, I just came from Estill County last year. They have Powell and Estill. Where I'm from, Lee County, we had Lee, Wolf, and Alice Lee. At the school that I taught in Northern Kentucky when I first started, we had 10 different feeder schools now converged into one building. And so, you know, all the things that we do for Clark County students. So. One thing that when I first came back to Clark County, one big push that I had was dual credit. There wasn't a whole lot. Under previous administration, so it was a huge push. I met with a lady named Lindy Bolt, who replaced a lady named Rebecca Simpson, BCTC, and was just a joy to work with. And so a couple of things that we did is we increased students and course offerings that we didn't have last year. And so we added two classes in computer science, which we had never had any classes in computer science that were eligible for credit previously. We have six classes in the building. Principles of Health Science we added this spring, so that was previously not offered. And then we added two classes in Carpentry where they didn't have any credit offerings last year. In Computer Science, the fall, we enrolled 28 students, which was equivalent to 84 college credits. In the welding in the fall, we had 37 students, which was 185 credits. Carpentry in the fall, we had 15 students, which was 75 credits. Health Science, we had 58 in the fall, which was equivalent to 225 credits. Welding this spring was 34 students, and that's 138 credits. Carpentry in the spring was 11, and I can't see that, maybe 58?
55.
Okay, 55 in Health Science in the spring. Can't see, we had 65 students, and how many hours was that? Like 195 credits. So the spring push in health science was where we enrolled all those students in either midterm for the spring and then also principles of health science. So we had a huge turnout in college credits to these students. And so that was a big push. That was a big thing. I was very, very proud. So the total students served, including duplicates for dual credit, because some students will take one dual credit class, and will take two. So there was 248 students, and then the total credits earned potentially 957. It's almost 1,000 college credits earned this year. And so in the fall of the next coming school year, we'll talk about that at the end, there's going to be some other classes added, and so that will only increase. For some industry certifications, we had health science at BNA. We had 25 students, which was 100% pass rate, as you all know earlier. Physical therapy assistant, we had 5 students, which was 100% pass rate. Robotics, we had 22. Pharmacy, we have not tested yet. That's going to come in May, and so I don't have that data yet. But if we got that, I've got high hopes for that. So I'm going for 100%. For our welding, we have 4 students who have earned their ABS 2F qualification. transportation, which again, we're not to the end of the year, so I know that that's going to increase as well, just going on the data that I have currently. Computer science, we were able to get 14 students passed on a computer science EOP, and that included also some juniors and seniors. For our carpentry, we had 14 students who earned ACCR track. You can turn that, make that 10 to 11, because I proctored the test this morning, so I added another one to that. Yep. Our OSHA 10, we still got some students earning that, and then that'll be 9 students who earned their OSHA 10 instruction. For automotive, we've got 13 students, and I can't see that number. Oh yeah, so I'm testing tomorrow with several students, and I'll probably be testing through next week because I've got some students I need to make some special accommodations for, and so I'll be doing all that, and I proctor all the exams in the school, so my teachers will have to try to get covered for that, so I'm doing that. We tested 66 students in NOFI, and we're going to do that May 17th through the 19th. I did about 16 students that I found that were not captured earlier in their high school career, and so we had 100% pass rate on those. So these students are going to be freshmen and sophomores, and so those students will be, you know, transition ready as freshmen and sophomores. And again, too, I can only do so much, and my teachers are the ones who do all that work. And so, kudos to them. Because again, too, without them, then we're not going to have these numbers. For our CTSOs, which are your protected student organizations, we had a very good year, I thought. We took 7 students down for HOSA, for state, and we had Ella, England Warner, and then also Ella Craig, who were first and second. And so they're eligible to go to nationals. And then Saturday, we had Skills USA, which was last Wednesday, Thursday, Friday. And Saturday was when the awards. And so we had Ian Solis, Brayden Long, Nick Warren, Brayden Lewis, Blake Hall, Lydia Chenault, who's now eligible to go to nationals in Atlanta, Georgia. And so we had representation from all of our program areas at ATC. And then also, another event that had happened earlier in the year was Blake Hall also placed overall in a voting competition at Campbellsville University. And then this Friday, we're going to another competition. Mr. Willoughby's got some students, and I'm redriving those students, and it's called Trade Wars, and that's hosted by Mason Community Technical College. And so that'd be this one. And so we've got some pictures of the students. So these are just carpentry projects that some of the students have been doing in carpentry. So we've got some end tables, we've got a shelter or a shed that we that Mr. Asa has been working on that's for sale currently, and then we have a project here with Braden. And again, these are just snapshots. I mean, there's so many other things that we do. You know, brevity with Mr. Howard, I can't get on. So these are some welding projects that Mr. Willoughby's been working on, and these are also for sale as for some fundraising. So we've got some firewood settings. We also have this bench that we have right here. He's also worked on several trailers for several individuals in the district. He's finishing up a grill for one of the assistant basketball coaches for the girls' basketball team. This was health science, so they went to UK for the reverse anatomy lab. And so these students actually got to build body parts, could actually So they get some hands-on. And again, too, we do technical clinics. I mean, there's a lot of things that, you know, again, just for time's sake, I couldn't get all the pictures in. Just some other things in closing is there's some pieces of equipment that we still have to come in because, again, we're always trying to update, keep our programs up to date with technology. We have a welding competition, which I mentioned earlier on April 28th. We have several more students to finish our industry certifications. Our steering advisory meeting is next week, which I'll send to all of you an invite for that. I should have industrial maintenance position. That's been vacant all year. I should have that job posted by the end of this week. Ms. Wise is also going to be retiring, my secretary, so I'll be also filling that position. We're adding a new pathway for computer science, which is a cybersecurity pathway. We're also adding a patient care technician in health science. And we're also adding several other classes for dual credit. So next year, freshmen welding will have an opportunity to earn dual credit. I'm working with BCTC so that our emergency procedures class, which hasn't been able to get full credit, they should get a CPR certification, which they already get, but they don't get any college credit for it. So then that'll also be another full credit opportunity for them to achieve. And then I'm hoping to add some more computer science. And then if we get someone into, my hope is that if we get a great candidate in for industrial maintenance, that I'm able to get them in so we can ask them industrial maintenance dual credit as well. And again, too, these are all possible from the work rate scholarships that the state provides for these students to get to you.
Thank you. Next up is Student Support Services. First item is consider approval of 1-1 Chromebook Registration Plan.
All right, thank you. When the pandemic hit in 2020, a lot of districts, thousands of districts, all over the country, we went 1-1 Chromebooks for distance learning. It was mandatory, something we had to do to continue learning. And then even when that pandemic lessened, we were all back in person. Chromebooks have become such an ingrained part of our learning and instruction, communication, collaboration, formative assessment, summative assessment, KSA test, K-prep. They just didn't go away, and they're just such an essential part of what we do now in schools. We have to think about how we're going to continue that. So initially, just to get 1-1 in 2020, and then in 2021, we made a couple of one-off purchases, which you all approved, obviously, just to get to 1-1 last year. Came about time to think about doing a long-term sustainability program, but I was fortunate enough to get awarded a grant for about 1,100 Chromebooks, which is about what we needed to continue to put off this plan well over here. So that worked out well, and however, we're now at the point where we need to think about more of a long-term sustainability program. So I sat down with Superintendent Howard for a little bit a couple weeks ago, and we felt like the best course of action after going over several plans was to put Baker, Campbell, GRC, and Phoenix on a four-year plan where the entire school will be refreshed with new Chromebooks every 4 years. So essentially, every year we're committing to buying 1/4 of the projected student enrollment for 5th through 12th students. So at the end of 4 years, no device will be older than 4 years old. At the elementary school level, we did the same. Our proposal is the same, other than it's on a 5-year rotation. Because at the younger levels, what we found, and the elementary principals, I believe, will attest to this when we had our principals meeting last week, was that at the younger levels, they just don't use the Chromebooks as much for various reasons. And so it wasn't as necessary to have them refreshed every 4 years, every 5 years was the better plan. Projected enrollment at the time of this presentation's upload was about 5,117. So if we did, like I said, if we did the proposed plan of buying for 1/4 of the projected student body, 5 through 12, and 1/5 of the projected student body, K through 5, that ends up being about 1,185 Chromebooks. Back one, Chris, sorry. Estimate about $270 a device, and that is an estimate. That totals about $320,000 we would need to be spent on Chromebooks for this upcoming year, upcoming 23-24 school year. Again, $270 is, I cannot stress enough that it's just an estimate. Whatever you all decide to do tonight will be put out for bid. So. Hopefully we can get lower than $270 per device. So our proposal then, how to pay for these roughly $1,185 per device. Chris, if you want to go ahead, two slides. Is to fund these Chromebooks, we're asking the board to commit Section 7 funds to $110 for every out of every Chromebook purchase. And the remaining $160 for every Chromebook purchase would come from KETS money and from school funds. You may notice on that first last sentence on the first paragraph, it says the principal at each school determines where devices go. So we would, at this point, at least in this first year of this plan, we would leave it up to the building administrators to decide the best way to disperse who would get the new Chromebooks. So elementary principals may say, it's fourth grade every year, they get slowly passed down. High school may say, you know, as a freshman every year, let that be their advice as they go through their 4 years of schooling, because like I said, they're on a 4 year cycle anyway, 4 year refresh anyway. So again, that's really the end of the principal at this point. Like I said, to fund each Chromebook, $110 commitment from the board for Chromebook. And then also, so that $270 does not include any sort of accidental damage protection. Different schools use, different schools damage them differently. There's some bigger culprits and there's not bigger culprits, and it's not any fault of anybody, it's just the way it is. But if the board wanted to commit to having a 3 year accidental damage protection per Chromebook, we would ask that the board commits $150 from Section 7 instead of $110. We typically, unless we just encounter a really great deal, the last 3 years, we really haven't gotten accidental damage protection on Chromebooks. They're supposed to be disposable, isn't the right word, but they're not supposed to last as long as your Windows laptops and your Mac laptops. So we haven't paid the extra money for it. Chris, next slide. So that's what we're asking the board to commit to. That's how we're planning to pay for it. We do ask that there be a small buy-in on student end. So if you look at page 5 of the PDF, Superintendent Howell and I are proposing an instructional fee per student, where every high school student pays $10. The reason that we have $10 is because they take theirs with them wherever they go, and the ones that choose to take a school on Chromebook. It just travels more places, and it's open to more damage potential. And as far as K-8 students, all we're asking is $5 for every K-8 student. This mimics what was the plan back in 2020 when we initially went one-to-one. The third bullet point says this money all goes into the school's existing Chromebook repair and replacement fund. So back in 2020 or 2021, you all approved the Chromebook repair and replacement fund specifically for repair and replacement, because that will happen. And so they take money from this fund specially designed for that, and that's how a lot of Chromebooks get repaired and replaced, obviously. And the last bullet point on that is there's actually an intentional damage fee structure still in place on the student Chromebook agreement. However you all decide to approve or not approve tonight, I will come back in May with a more updated damage fee structure, which just some more updated wording on the student Chromebook agreement. I wanted to get a plan approved first before reworded any student Chromebook agreements. Sorry. Last page of the PDF, just a couple general bullet points. Right now we have, every school has some loaners, some extras, some 5-year-old devices, 6-year-old devices that they can give out. It's kind of loaners, it's devices that are being fixed. Second bullet point, any students who can enroll after the purchase, the district can take all that fund out of just general fund money. Like I said, I estimated 1,185 as our projected need. Well, if we have more students enrolled, which would be a fantastic thing, that would also require a Chromebook. So year by year, the district general fund will fund those extras. Like I said, I'll put this out for bid annually with the potential for renewals if we can get a really good price that we think fits our budget. And probably most importantly is the final bullet point on the final page. So I kind of buried the lead there. This is a refresh plan. I may come back again, 12 months from now and ask for something not completely different, but amended in some way, because we've done a Chromebook refresh plan exactly 0 times in our district's history. So things are going to happen. The changes are going to be needed today. So all I'm asking for on this is just really for this next 12 months. So any questions on that? So that kind of depends on each school. They will be used as loaner devices, handout repair devices. At the elementary school levels, they'll get sifted down to the lowest grade levels. At the school level, if students, if the administration there wants to look at maybe having the Chromebooks stay with a student after they graduate, which we've only kind of talked about but not had any formal discussion on, then those extra Chromebooks would stay. We would need extra loan or repair Chromebooks, because if every Chromebook was leaving at the end of the year, we wouldn't have any left for extras and loaners. No, all I can say is they get used. The extras, they definitely get used for a myriad of things. We definitely don't. Even most Chromebooks go end of life, EOL, and they stop receiving security updates after 5 years, but they're still usable. They're not usable for every single thing. Maybe not testing, but they're usable for the classroom. If we win, what
route? Any property has to be surplus, you can really sell it.
So the proposal would be built into the 2024 budget, the plan is? Yes. So tonight is asking the board to approve the proposed plan, even though you will take it out to put out RFP for the first year?
Yes, definitely for the first, definitely for the first year. But in that RFP, I'll write into it that there will be the option for two subsequent year renewals, depending on if we want to take them all down.
Those work good for the plan, put out RFP, and then definitely come back to the board and say, here's the result of the RFP, this is
Yes. Similar to what we've done with some of our big technology, other technology purchases, where I come back after the RFP and say, this is the winning bid, this is who we feel is the winning bid.
So we're not approving the final dollar. We just approve.
Yeah, you're correct. You're approving a plan where the board would set aside $110 per Chromebook, and that students would pay $10 if they're 9 through 12, and $5 if they're K through 8.
Do we have any type of plan in this?
We have a bill that into this very first one.
In my understanding of this section 7 is that we need the board to tell, most likely we're going to put $110 in each Chromebook, and school has to use it for that specific purpose.
Yes, and the way I understand it, that money actually going to go to that school to even use something else. It's already pre-dedicated to only go to a Chromebook purchase. So it initially started out $5 a child because everyone was taking theirs home, and then the schools came back in person and didn't have their student take them, and then their students take theirs home. They didn't collect a $5 fee.
Thank you.
If it is, it's not a major issue, or I haven't been alerted to the issue. There, our STCs here at GRC do a good job of collecting from all those. So our STCs, our teachers here, and STCs in particular, our school technology coordinators at all the schools, particularly here, do a good job of the last day of testing. They actually collect the Chromebooks right then because the students all have out their Chromebooks to do the KSA or K-Pro testing. So that's when they collect them. That's like the best way to get them. You're not have to worry about a kid, students bringing them back after they graduate or something.
And I will say, last year, my son's freshman year, they took him out so early, he was in
Yeah, there's certainly a myriad of plans and cost structures out there.
Because I mean, I'd love to be able to play with them. They can tell me that anyway. If they're out there, I mean, I don't need some.
Yeah. Yeah, that's kind of why I touched on that, because I know the last several years that we've discussed these plans, and that has been bandied about a little bit. But I think right now the need to have extras and loaners, especially in the first year of the plan, is so that we're not stuck in a situation where we just don't have what we need when it comes time for testing. We have regional 4 or 5 year old devices. The kids haven't turned on and allowed because they prefer their own device because their device is 4 years old and they haven't been using it. So my recommendation is that we, at least in this first year, we don't approach the idea of students taking them after the 4 years. I know Superintendent Howard and Matt is having discussed that. I will say that a lot of districts in 2020, a lot of districts did that and have backed off from that. That they prefer to have the extra devices. Again, just anecdotal from monthly meetings I got to with other CIOs, but numerous people have talked about how the better plan is to just have the Chromebooks extra.
Well, yeah, I get that.
Initially,
you're going to have kids in 2 years.
We do surplus. Companies that will come and pay us to take them for us.
as your packet says, we put an RFP out at the end of March, and I was asking for Baker, Stir Station, and Shear to get new serving lines. So basically, those three schools still have the original serving lines from when those schools were built. So obviously, there's issues. We started to see rust, which is a huge health issue and that kind of thing. So it was time now that we've got some money back in the bank, now that we're back feeding kids every day, to go ahead and spend this money where it's needed in the equipment. And so I got one bid back, which I was kind of shocked, but I think right now there's a whole lot of companies out there that are really busy. But anyway, we got a bid back with a maximum cost of $216,986. This cost reflects a higher end project at Baker. I think in my note I originally had Shear. Baker's line is going to resemble more of what you've seen at RDC, that nicer updated serving line that we put in there before COVID. And then the Shear and Strode will resemble more like what you see at Concrete, which we put RDCs and Concrete in around the same time, so before COVID. So that's kind of the look that that you'll see at the elementary, and then you'll see what RDCs looks like at Baker. The Baker line will also include the merchandiser, which is in the center of the two lines at RDC, which houses like the milk and juice and that kind of thing, which when you start to get older kids, it's just sort of more of a merchandising plus as far as that goes. And it's a space saver for that line. It keeps us from having to have one of those big giant mufflers on each end of the line. So we've kind of reorganized that line at Baker, so it is a little bit of a bigger job, but nevertheless, I think they're all going to turn out great, and we're supposed to be having those completed by the end of July. So after tonight, if you approve this, I'll be sending the information to the company, and they'll go and get it ordered, and she says, you know, probably 6 to 8 weeks, and then we work on install. Yes, they come, they bring a couple of people with them, and then I have a couple of the maintenance guys that'll be there to, you know, just kind of make sure everything goes good. To help us out, yeah. So they're good about that.
This is also coming out of
the This is coming out of food service budget, yes. Like I said, looking for us, we're feeding kids again.
Yeah, yeah. Awesome.
Any questions?
All in favor?
information back from Patrick and Associates, which is local here to Winchester. So the fee that she is proposing is $22.5, which is up from the auditors that we have used prior. They were $17.3 last year. But $22.5 is really kind of right in the range of what most districts have reached out to the others, and are all paying in that $20,000 range. So this really is within range of what is probably typical. We've been kind of paying a low for the last several years. But, so I would recommend that you accept the proposal that was submitted. She has all the qualifications that we look for in the RFP. She's worked with the state auditor historically, so she's got a lot of experience in school.
Any questions? Have a motion. So, Mr. Newman, makes a motion. Do I have a second? Second by Ms. Ritchie, all in favor?
Aye.
Passes 5-0. Next is to consider discussion approval of primary banking services.
So, our primary banking depository, we had two submissions, one from Traditional Bank, our existing, and they offered the same that we're actually have now, which is the Fed funds rate minus 15 basis points, which currently that rate is 4.85%, with a floor of 0.5%. And then People's Exchange Bank also submitted a bid at a fixed rate of 3.15% with a floor of 0.25. So just looking at interest rates, I mean, it's best to stay with Traditional Bank with what has been proposed as far as our primary depository. So I'm recommending that we go another year with Traditional Bank.
Any questions?
So that's talking with Traditional Bank. operating versus our bond money. So with the bond money, like I said, the same type of proposals, all really all the same offers. Traditional bank was the 4.75, this was 3.15, and then Compass presented a ladder investment, all coinciding with, you know, you can be able to invest in certificates of deposit or U.S. Treasury bonds and roll it down with our construction schedule. But once again, 4.75 fixed for the entire time, and then the laddering of what Compass proposed, it's actually about $64,000 more in interest for the traditional bank, which is where it's sitting right now at 4.75%. We'll be earning on it while we're waiting on these other things. So my proposal is to leave the bond money with traditional bank as well, fixed for the 4.75. Now, there is not an option for it to be the 4.85. It is going to be strictly the investment account of the 4.75.
What's that total dollar amount?
So over the period of time till basically December of next year, it's like $750,000 in interest for the loan money.
Any questions? I'll make a motion to approve the 4.75 traditional bank deposits. Second. Thank you. All in favor?
Aye.
Passes 5-0. Next is consider approval of updated stacking allocations. Let's read.
Okay, so the big changes you're going to see are actually within the summary pages of the dollar amounts that are working budget pieces. The enrollment is, we have kept it the same. We actually pulled updated numbers in March, and we were just slightly down by about 65 students. So not a huge down, but down from the October numbers. And so we didn't take anything away. We didn't add staff either. So as far as staffing allocation numbers go, the staffing is the same that was presented at the tentative. What is changing is we are actually proposing a music teacher be shared between GRC and RDC being added to the budget. So that you'll see that. So basically anything on those forms you're going to see flip to the next page. In red is what has changed. We have also, Mr. Payson just spoke about the Chromebook allocation, so that is specifically listed for each school, that what, one-fourth of RDC, GRC, Baker, one-fourth of their enrollment, what that looks like, 110 for Chromebook, and then a fifth of enrollment for the elementary schools, what that looks like for their budgets. So we would set that money aside in a district instructional account, basically, that the school does not touch. It's allocated to them for their use, but it's managed at the district level, essentially. And that's also what we do for their instructional stipends. I mean, we give them a lot of amount of money, but it sits in the district account to facilitate those stipends on their behalf, the conventions to pay for those stipends. And that's the other piece you'll see change. I know you all are used to each school has its own stipend schedule, and they're kind of all different titles, different amounts. So one of the things we've done that you will see when we bring salary tables and the stipend schedules back to you in May for approval is that we kind of condense the instructional stipends to a more one-page document, very specific, very condensed, and given specific dollar amounts. So you see that change from their tentative level. Basically, we're given GRC $40,000, RDC and Baker $20,000, and then each of the elementary schools $85,000. So it's down for some schools, it's up for the elementaries. We just thought that was, you know, more equitable for their locations of what they needed to help supplement their instructional in the building. So, and then on GRC, you'll see project graduation. I had it allocated at $2,500, but I think you all are wanting to stay with the $5,000. Is my understanding we upped that this year, so I've upped that for next year. So those are the changes as far as the allocations go. And all of this will be reflected in the May budget when it's brought back.
So the board approved project graduation $5,000 this year, so.
Is the music teacher going in addition to, is it like a music class or?
Sure. So when we look at programming and programming needs, the performing arts teachers in this role had approached me about me right now. She is living between the two buildings and trying to grow that program. I felt like we were never going to be able to do it unless we supported her and the band. far as the other changes, I've had a couple meetings and talked to all the principals, and they are extremely minimal, actually excited about some of the changes and adjustments. Including Mr. Johnson.
Any other comments or questions? Do we have a motion?
I think the motion to approve the updated staffing allocation for the 2022.
Motion by Mr. Dorsey, do we have a second? Second by Ms. Hall, all in favor?
Aye.
Passes five zero. Thank you, Ms. Hall. Now staff retention and improvement. Dr. Penny Parrish.
Hello. So it's going to be super quick. So all four job descriptions for our new admin assistant are replacing those other ones that we talked about and have been combined. So your admin ones are elementary and intermediate, and two is middle and high, three are district design positions, and four is just the superintendent's assistant.
And we have already approved the pay scales for those, these are just revised job descriptions. Questions, comments? Have a motion? Motion by Mr. Bennett, second. Second by Ms. Dorsey, all in favor?
Aye.
Passes five zero. Next up is consent items. Is there any items that any board member would like to pull off, discuss, comment? Everybody a second.
Oh, you guys are picking that up, I'm just getting a couple of days.
I skipped the motion.
That's different, I'm in the board, I'm a brevity, I'm caught with that, with me.
Yeah.
I know, I still have a couple academic things we've got coming up, it's that time of the year. I know we celebrated a lot of academics and athletics tonight. District is actually going to start a district accreditation process with Kanye. We start that on May the 1st. We're excited, it's a rotation, so you get accredited for a certain number of years. So we're in the last year, so we're going to go through the process, and again, we are excited to showcase some of that we're doing. Other dates, state testing, KSA is going to start, the window is May 5th through the 25th. I know that this will work extremely hard on getting those schedules specific to each school, information out from your building, principal, and team, making sure we give our best effort to represent Clark County. Previously voted on, last day of school is May the 25th for students, closing day for staff is the 26th. My favorite day of the entire year is graduation, which will be on the 26th at the football stadium at 7 p.m. So we get to celebrate our pre-K through K graduates, most of them going right here in Clark County the entire time. The only other thing, I want to give you an update on kind of things you approved before, our work day, again, it's essential, I think we continue to build these into our schedule, to our calendar, because we're going to provide targeted trainings to our staff. We're going to be getting day four of Kagan training. This is for all administrators. I've been, you're a rockstar, I've learned lots of things, I celebrate things. But really focusing on engaging kids in the classroom. So administrators, but also our teacher leaders, we have one more day that will be the 31st, I believe, in May. That'll be day five, that'll finish everyone up. That group will then get to coaching training, and the next year, every teacher in the district will be trained, and that's part of the allocation you guys voted on for Kagan district-wide. So we'll also be reviewing MASS standards, 5 through 12, on that day as well, continuing our work, tightening up congruency to make sure we're teaching standards. We're not off left, right, or what I like, what I don't like, the specific standards and how we make those aligned in our classrooms every day. So that's kind of my updates, again, I want to give you folks on academics, sometimes we do a culture climate, but very proud of Ms. Fitton and her department's work. And provide a great facility classroom every day.
Thank you, Mr. Howard. My apologies.
Well, I just want to buy time for you to review, we're a good team.
On to the consent items, is there